Joni Ray here. I'm in Pennsylvania fracking news from around Pennsylvania. Flush only in 9 West Virginia counties. This was originally posted and published by Dory Hippauf at No Fracking Way. So I think we've all pretty much heard what is going on back in West Virginia and the emergency that they had that is affecting over 300,000 people. So right now they are on a flush-only order. No drinking, cooking, bathing, washing, brushing teeth, no watering plants, no washing clothes, nothing. Okay, so the company with the leaking tanks owns Freedom Industries. Their combined 13 tanks are capable of holding 4 million gallons. These are the counties that have been affected. Don't drink the water ban. Okay. So the disaster was declared, and hopefully they're still getting water. I hope you guys are all getting water, and my heart goes out to all of you. This has got to be just an amazing disaster to have to try to do your daily living. Okay, so Gary Southern of Freedom Industries said, "We're sorry." No surprise there. With rare exceptions, most corporations are sorry when they create a disaster. But being sorry after the fact is more cost-effective than spending money to prevent the situation from happening in the first place. And then they want to blame it on the recent cold temperatures. In other words, it wasn't their fault. Again, no surprise. The chemicals being reported as 4-methylcyclohexane methanol, which is used in the froth flotation process of coal washing and preparation. Some of the dangers are nausea, vomiting, dizziness, headaches, diarrhea, reddened skin, itching, rashes. Can cause eye irritation, skin, throat irritation, trouble breathing. Most of the material data sheets that you will pull up don't have any information, actually. So here, fracking chemicals in your water. Methylcyclohexane is a natural product, which is isolated from light petroleum distillates. With methylcyclohexane methanol is a manufactured product used to float purified coal fines in a frother processing step. This first is a hydrocarbon with toxicity similar to kerosene, which is very volatile, right? Caustic. The second is an alcohol with toxicity similar to octanol. Neither of them belongs in drinking water, and it will be interesting to see if West Virginia officials handle the fouling of nearly a third of the state's surface waters with nary a warning from the coal processing company, with the severity the situation deserves. Absolutely. And then here's a little background history. Here's how they treat us. Brad Miller, General Manager of Regulatory Affairs at Anadarko Petroleum, was asked how to explain the fracking chemicals. Tell them biocides are bleach. Hydraulic fracturing. We talk about biocides. Wow, that's a big word. That's bleach. So we've got to start talking bleach. So we need to kind of bring what we put in there down to where people can understand. Tell them polyacrylamides are chapstick. Yeah, that's it. It's chapstick. People really get worried when you talk about putting polyacrylamides in frac, that they're going to be pumping down into a well. What is that? It's chapstick. Don't worry about it. Tell them surfactants are Dove soap. Oh, don't you get a visual? Dove soap, it's so nice for your skin, makes you so soft. It's a surfactant, it's Dove soap. Now, what is appalling to me is to be treated like an idiot. Like we don't really deserve. That was not an explanation of what fracking chemicals are. It was belittling. And here's a little bit of fluff on the company. Current situation. So they've said that between 2 to 5,000 gallons of material leaked from a hole in a storage tank designed to hold up to 350,000 gallons. A concrete block dike meant to serve as a secondary containment also leaked, allowing an undetermined amount of chemical into the Elk River. Allowing an undetermined amount, but here they're saying 2 to 5,000 gallons. Okay, well, they can say whatever they want because they'll probably never really tell us the truth. Contents of two additional tanks from the Freedom Industries Etowah River Terminal was ordered to be emptied on Friday afternoon. This was followed by an early evening order for Freedom Industries to empty all the tanks at the facility. All the tanks for a combined total of 4 million gallons. Get it out of there. Go get it safe. And the reason why they told them to get it all out of there and off the property is because the secondary measure for safety was breached. It had a leak in it as well. Okay, then in an air quality enforcement order, the officials who arrived at the site discovered that no spill containment measures had been initiated, and that an accumulating MCHM leak pool was seeping through a dike adjacent to the river and was in the river downstream, and an oil sheen was observed. There was no orders up above. I didn't read anything where anybody said anything about air quality enforcement, air quality control, or what you're going to be exposed to. The problem, let me go back to this real quick because I wanted to show you these rivers. How the Elk River flows, it hooks up with a couple of streams, the Big Spring Fork and the Old Field Fork, and they flow above ground for several miles before it sinks into a network of caverns and flows underground for more than 5 miles. That is scary right there. There's no remediation process for cleaning this up out of the water. There's no mitigation. There's no way to control it. It's in the river. And this flows into caverns and underground for 5 miles. Wow. That's unbelievable. And here, if there is an accident release, these are the measures. You're supposed to use an inert material to absorb, it. There's no way to do that in a river. Prevent it from going into the sewers. It's already in the sewers. It's already everywhere. Be careful that the product is not present at a concentration level above the TLV, which means the threshold limit value. Check the threshold limit value on the MSDS and with local authorities. MSDS is the Material Safety Data Sheet, which I haven't been able to find. So you're going to want to check the threshold limit value with the Material Data Safety Data Sheet with local authorities. You have that right to do that. I would encourage everyone to start looking into what this situation really is all about. and how bad it really is. Here is the chemical page here. I will be leaving all the links. Let's go look at the safety risk statements. Now, I have never been a fear-mongering person. I don't believe in that. I do, however, believe in my famous statement, and that is, when you are armed with knowledge, you can then make better choices. Personally, if I lived back there right now, I would be wearing a mask. My cats and dogs, they'd all be in the house. They wouldn't even be outside. Or I would pick up everybody and I would get out of there for a while, depending on where you live. But if you can smell it, you're being exposed to it. Okay? So here's some of the risks. Can be eye damage, may cause cancer, may cause heritable genetic damage, danger of serious damage to health by prolonged exposure. This means exposure in the air. May cause cancer by inhalation, very toxic to aquatic organisms. May cause long-term adverse effects in the aquatic environment. Toxic to flora, fauna, soil organisms, bees. May cause long-term adverse effects in the environment. The reason is because they cannot clean it up in the water. Dangerous for the ozone layer. May impair fertility. This is a poisonous chemical. And yes, it is being diluted, but until they come out and say how safe it is, what the threshold limit value is, just like with Fukushima. Okay, if you don't want me to be afraid that there's fallout, then tell me what's in the air. Let me know so I can make that decision whether I need to get out or need to wear a mask. How do I take care of my children? How do I take care of my family, my pets? How do you take care of your elderly parents that are in a nursing home? You can't expect somebody else to do it. Knowledge is everything. May impair fertility, may cause harm to an unborn child, possible risk of impaired fertility, possible risk to an unborn child, may cause lung damage if swallowed. Repeated exposure may cause skin dryness or cracking. The vapors can cause drowsiness and dizziness. Possible risk of irreversible effects. Danger of cumulative effects can cause burns. A lot of these are redundant, but you can clearly see for yourself. I will leave the links and you can come in and you can go through these. These are the combinations of risks, which is basically what I just went over. There's more. Possible risk of irreversible effects through inhalation. Okay. As always, God bless.